got an Indian sample, right? Yeah.
Do your research. Yeah.
This where it started, right? Yeah. Yeah. It's the oeuvre, baby.
DJ Rekha in the area.
Wow, 20 years. I'm looking at great friends and colleagues here, and just it's really wonderful and strange to see all of you together, because you have all arrived at different points in time of our 20 years here at NYU. Just think of those glasses as wind chimes in the background. Okay, so. My name is Jack Chen. I was hired here at NYU in 1996, 20 years. So I'm just going to give a few brief comments about a series of spaces that I've tried to open up in this crazy life of this crazy, hyper-specialized, intermingled, contested cityscape of Gotham that is still just coming out of a century of anti-Asian segregation and national exclusion. In this city of extreme contradictions, in the nation-state of unprecedented wealth, impoverishing all life, in a world out of whack, we, its denizens, might sample unfettered access to, at one instance, then be profiled, poked, prodded, stabbed another. From one war to another war to another war to another war, this security state of shopping till we drop and permanent war, protecting unfettered freedom for a few, at what price for the many? Artists, writers, curators, playwrights, DJs, slam stand-ups, with producers, publicists, directors, and all the essential staffers, bobbing and weaving, ducking and covering, rolling and flowing, opening up spaces we didn't know existed, exercising muscles we didn't know we had, getting us to feel and activate in ways we never imagined. 20 years. And it's not been possible without the amazing staff and friends that we've worked with all along. So just for a moment, I want to acknowledge a few people. Laura Chen Schultz, who just ducked in. Laura Chen Schultz. Alexander Chang, who is upstate. He's not able to join us. Ruby Gomez. Where's Ruby? Ruby. Okay, she's outside. And Amita Magnani. Amita. But also, I heard that Anthony Escobar is going to be coming later on. Okay, many of you remember Anthony. Swati Khurana is here. Really happy that you're here, Swati.
Yay,
Rosa King is here. Mansi Kong is here. And Sam is here. Where's Sam? Okay, Sam, there you are. Thank you. And I know there are other people here, but sorry if I missed your name. Now, 20 years of artists in residence, and I had to kind of look at the list. So let me just read you the list, because it's kind of an amazing, astounding list of people. I'm going to kind of go back to our first artists and then work our way to the present day. Tomie Arai, our very first artist in residence. Not by coincidence, by any means. I was really so happy that you could inaugurate our whole program. Ananya Bhattacharjee in 1997-1998, Jessica Hagedorn 1998-1999, Ping Chong after that, David Henry Hwang 2000-2001, David, and Kensen Ong, Corky Lee, Fei Chang, Helen Zia, Regie Cabico 2005-2006. DJ Rekha, right after the year. Suzanne Leotawa, Brian Ouyang and Aaron Jafaris, Sahir Hamad, and Larry Hama, Roger Shimamura, Chitra Ganesh and Miriam Ghani, Harry Kondabolu, Jack Gray, and Beatrice Glow, who's just right back here. So Beatrice, really happy you're here. Excuse me, just one second here. So tonight, Amita came up with really kind of a wonderful round robin format. What we're going to do is we're going to begin with Tomie, who's going to be talking about DJ Rekha, and DJ Rekha is going to be talking about Regie. And Reggie's going to be talking about David Henry Hwang. David Henry Hwang's going to be talking about Jessica, and Jessica about Tomie. Part of what's really wonderful about this is that we haven't done this whatsoever. And some of you are meeting each other for the first time, but all of you know of each other a great deal. And it's really a wonderful space to open up, to kind of begin to kind of talk across a lot of the times and differences that we've had at APA. And I just want to say something briefly about what is unique about the Artist in Residence program, because every year the staff kind of gathers in a secret dark room somewhere at NYU, and we begin brainstorming about who would we love to have with us, and who would we love to have with us with our students and with the communities that people are representing. Many of the people have been doing work in New York for many years, and in some ways that's our natural place in which we really feel is most important. But also many people have come from afar, come in and out of New York, and are very much a part of pushing the boundaries of what Asian, what Pacific, what America. And it's really Asians, the many Pacifics, the many Americas might represent, and how we can begin to not just celebrate one biological identity category, which is not really what we've been doing, but to begin to kind of understand the movement and flow and interchange, the improvisation that happens across these boundaries constantly. And in many ways, I think, along with the studies program that Sukhdev is going to be talking about in a short while, it's really the artists in residence who are in some ways most free to be doing that, to be dreaming that, to be imagining, paying respects to the past, but also imagining what that future that we still haven't had, that we need to have, can be. So it's really the artist program that in many ways has been driving, I think, so much of what we do. And in some ways, it's the easiest linkage to get NYU out of the bubble of the classroom and to be thinking about the city at large, the region at large, and these larger categories and what they all mean. So it's really, you know, once we come up with somebody, we ask them what they would like to do. And every year has been different. Every year has been unique. We've gone from doing operas, epic operas, to organizing amazing work at the Public Theater around Dog Eaters, to Reggie's amazing stand-up performance, for over the whole semester, really. But I remember one evening, in which we had your program and everybody lit up their phones, you know, shouting, Reggie, 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 you know. And it was just, we've had so many memorable events and evenings. So I'm really looking forward to seeing what you all do with each other's work. And also really hoping that we all can come back again and again. Beatrice Glow is doing some amazing work with linking the Pacific in many ways and indigeneity and looking at this weird thing that New Yorkers don't know about. First of all, the Lenape peoples, in which land we're in, that's never been really acknowledged properly and has always been really a colonized space. So what does it mean for a place like NYU and New York City to be on colonized land? That's never been worked through. But also this exchange, which seems to be a footnote in history, in which the island of Manhattan, which was owned by the Dutch, we know that, was exchanged for this island in Indonesia called Rune for its nutmeg, which was far more valuable than anything that was in Manhattan Island at the time, right? So she's been playing with that, and we're hoping to send her, not because we don't love her, but because she wants to go to this island in Rune to actually do the documentation, to look at that exchange. And those of you who remember the star footprint of the fort of New Amsterdam, what is amazing is that that same fort is actually on the island of Rune. So island to island really opens up all sorts of vistas of creative, also creative imagination, but also the smellscape, the perfumes of the botanical perfumes of both places are part of what she's working on. So there's so much going on, and we really look forward to hearing more and more about it. So without any more delay, I'd like to invite Professor Sukhdev Sandhu to come up and talk a little bit about the studies program that is really in partnership with the Institute. Sukhdev Sandhu.
Some of the words that I feel you only hear in this context, words about freedom, words about dreaming, the positive use of the word imagination. I've take those for granted, but actually sitting here right now, I think, no, it only happens in the context of Jack and the APA program. My job is as a director of APA studies, but essentially I'm a fanboy. I came... Maybe it was a terrible mistake, but I came to New York just for 1 year as a kind of post-doctoral student, fully intending to go back across the Atlantic, and I had the privilege and the happy happenstance to meet Jack and to teach within the APA Studies program and to be invited to apply for a job and then scroll forward many years, gray hairs, midriffs, saggy knees, and here I am. But essentially, nothing has changed in that time. The sheer oddness of the APA Institute and APA studies, its kind of elbowiness, its kind of awkwardness, and its embrace of awkwardness is as kind of sort of powerful and catalytic as ever. I thought I would just very quickly, partly for my own, just to kind of sort of defamiliarize myself this afternoon, I thought I'd just kind of think about why it is that I find it such a kind of odd space to be. First of all, and of course, this year's ongoing sort of markings, commemorations, celebrations are a part of this, is what I really, really value about APA, and I'm going to talk about it as a kind of totality here, is that it's born of struggle. It wasn't given to us. It was fought for by Jack, by educators, by the students themselves, who chained themselves to the university, who locked themselves into rooms, who kind of refused just to be happy with the morsels they were given. It was an organic and in its own way kind of indigenous entity, a kind of revolt against the popular understandings of what Asian Americans were meant to be. What they were meant to study, what they were meant to desire itself, and the kind of the muscle memory of that fight persists and reverberates to this day. I have a particular interest in kind of non-institutionality. Put another way, it's often very embarrassing to be at NYU, to sort of walk around sort of streets that you love, where the imperial purple flag sort of blows in the midst, and you sort of feel, I am part of the belly of a beast. What can I do, oh God, to atone? one of the things that APA does is I think it still feels in sync with and inspired by the dynamics of rogue academia, para-academia, by DIYism, by people with maybe no money, but lots of energy, lots of hunger, lots of desire. Things created always in a spirit of defiance and utopianism. People who don't think of austerity just as an excuse not to do things, not to imagine, not to kind of create things, but actually as a kind of incitement to focus and drill down on the things that they love and that they really care about. Most of the most important things, it's always seemed to me, about APA here at NYU are born in a period where we were invisible, mostly sort of inaudible, and that did not stop anybody from fashioning a fraction of the world that they wanted. Very germane to this evening, these kind of very sort of dulled silos which universities kind of pride themselves on, between academia and community, between scholarship and activism, between artists and critics or commentators, they've never seemed to apply at all. APA, for me, has always been a kind of advertorial to porosity, to kind of sort of mutual enrichment between these otherwise kind of segregated, almost sort of schizophrenic spheres. I loved, and I've always found it a privilege to be in the presence of a program and a unit for which artists are absolutely central. And that has taken it upon itself to offer spaces. Time is so precious, time to think, time sometimes not to produce things, not to be on that chain of production of the gig, to offer gestational spaces, incubatory spaces to comedians, to DJs, to playwrights, to performers, gallerists, filmmakers, some of them well-known, some of them on the brink of being well-known, and treating them in exactly the same way. The P in APA also I take for granted. It spoke from the get-go to me towards something even more outward-facing, even more hemispheric, even more transnational than the already expansive, capacious categories of Asian America. And also there was a way for somebody like me, whose parents are from India, where it was very easy when I came here to kind of sort of slot into the kind of rather kind of sometimes rather narcissistic kind of bolt holes certain kinds of identity politics, certain kinds of intra-ethnic factionalism. For many of the people, DJs, musicians, activists that I was inspired by, APA told us there was more to be gained, frankly, by exploring and celebrating affinities, solidarities, difficult continuities with other Asian histories and Asian politics. I'd also say APA has the best food, that goes without saying. It had the best architecture. Some of you will remember the kind of the glorious structures that Maya Lin built when we were at 269 Mercer Street. And also, again, I really valued the links that APA fostered and the bridges that it created with high school students in the city, not to kind of think of education as this kind of little privatized realm of 18 to 22-year-olds, but something that is bigger and bigger and longer. Much, of course, has changed since 1996, as Jack has pointed out, at NYU, in New York, in America, in the rhetorics surrounding Asia itself. But it goes without saying, I think, and I hope we all agree, that APA is still needed now as much as it ever was. It's needed, amongst other things, to advocate for communities in this city threatened and attacked by gentrification, by students imperiled by debts, and sometimes the kind of the imaginatively foreclosing corporatized rhetorics and multiculturalism and diversity. It speaks up for brilliant artists whose work is still all too often regarded as supposedly primarily of interest to niche demographics. And most of all, it's for people who have still in 2016, have to put up with moronic questions, such as, am I supposed to bow to say hello? Or is it the year of the dragon? 20 years later, APA is still, for me, a pathfinder, a lighthouse, a home beyond my home, and a kind of twinkling-eyed troublemaker. Long may it continue.
Thank you, and good evening. It's always nice to go first. Being the first artist in residence, actually, there were absolutely no expectations of me that first year. So it was really a liberating experience. I just want to thank NYU and the APA study in the APA Institute, Jack, Amita, Laura, and Ruby, for inviting me tonight. This is actually a lot of fun, which isn't something that always happens. To be able to respond to another artist's work, and I realize that this is sort of an unlikely pairing because of perhaps my response, my being paired with DJ Rekha, because of age, because of perhaps our backgrounds, our differences in lifestyle, my deep fear of making a fool of myself by dancing in public. There are so many reasons why our lives may not have overlapped. But in fact, after meeting DJ Rekha, learning more about her process, I feel like there are so many ways that we see the world in the same way. And being a visual artist, I wanted to respond visually. So I'll be showing a PowerPoint. But before I do that, I just wanted to make a few comments. The text in the PowerPoint is from a piece that DJ Rekha wrote for the Asian American Literary Review, which was a special issue on the 10th anniversary of 9/11. There were several things that she said that really resonated with me, and so I've included that. One of the things that I learned about her that I feel really sympathetic with is that she uses her music to transform public spaces into places of celebration. And I think that as a public artist, that is something that we all aspire to. Another thing that she said was that she didn't like to make, she wasn't into making an iPhone playlist, that when she worked, she listened to the people in the room. And I think that artists who work with communities have to listen to the people in the room when they work. They have to be responsive, and they have to hear and intuit what people want. And finally, I'm really so excited to be doing this because the music that she plays is wonderful. It's no matter how old you are or where you may come from, what walk of life you may be leading, there is just no denying that it's music that captures you, pushes you, makes you respond in ways that are so human and so full of life. So with that, I'm just going to go into this PowerPoint. With my fingers crossed that it works, how should I do this?
Amazing. I'm verklempt. I don't know what else to say. Before I start talking about Regie, and I guess we'll save some of the comments for later, I just want to say that this opportunity singularly changed my life in so many ways that I can't express. As a DJ, to be legitimized is something that it's a constant struggle, especially now when everyone's a DJ. And I'll just leave it at that, especially with the parents. But I made a mix, and I'm just gonna say a few words and let you just experience the music. I cannot dare read Regie's writing because I wouldn't do it justice. So I encourage you to look at it on your own. You don't have to stay in your seats if you want. The first time I'm gonna take you. You don't have to stay in your seats if you want. The first time I remember Regie was on St. Mark's Place, original Asian American Writers Workshop space. He did a bit with Geetha Reddy about a Filipino talk show. Sloppy was there, and it really blew my mind. It was entertaining, it was funny, it felt like something familiar and comfortable. It was an auntie I didn't know I had. And throughout the years, Regie's work has transcended boundaries in so many ways. And he was the artist in residence before me, and those were very big, impossible ideals to fill. Sometimes he was still there when I was trying to get to my desk. what Regie presented to me the first time I saw him was possibility about ways of thinking about self and gender that I didn't know I needed to think about, which I came to later in life. Just rereading his text, you know, I saw him on Def Jam Comedy, I've seen him do stand-up, I've been accosted by him at a restaurant, eating dinner with friends, where he's doing his bit. In some ways he's always on, but just because he's funny, and it doesn't mean the words don't have meaning, they're very deep, intense, they display a range of emotion, they flip the idea of where am I from into a whole deeper level, and who am I on so many different levels, in so many different ways. What Jack had said earlier, and what Sukhdev had mentioned about creating homes, each one of his work creates a special space, and as you can tell, I'm into space. I'm just honored to be in the company of these great people, and you know, in the same, right next to Reggie, it's great. Thank you very much. So you can just listen. Run out my time.
Wow, this is the closest thing to a high school reunion. I have never been to one, but if it's like this, then this is super cool. Thank you, Rekha. think, is there a shower in the back? All right, so let me just start off that when I received the residency in 2006, it was poignant because I was leaving New York at that time. So I feel that having the residency and being in the company of incredible artists was the kind of validation that that I felt. So I'm truly grateful to APA Studies for that opportunity. It was sort of the work that I had been doing the last 13 years before. When Amita asked me to be a part of this, I was working on the Every 28-Hour Play Project in Washington, D.C., at Capturing Fire, which is a spoken word festival, queer spoken word festival. And Claudia was taking some of the works in the workshop and presenting it at the festival. And one of the plays was by David Henry Hwang. And I really love this work. I've admired David's work as an undergrad actor at Tisch School of the Arts. I read his plays. And almost 30 years later, I'm able to read one of his plays before you, so it's full circle. In this piece, Every 28 Hours Plays is inspired by Ferguson. Claudia Alec commissioned playwrights to do two-minute plays. And David Henry Hwang was so generous to add a piece here, one of the very few Asian voices in the collection. I am also a fan of the short form of writing. I don't write more than a page. I usually take a nap if it's more than that. So I like to keep them short and pithy that way. But I think in this piece, even in its distilled minute form, you will see all the trademarks of David Henry Hwang's work, the structure, smart characters, a surprise, and I'll let you experience that. So the play is called My Life Matters. And Amy, which I'll read, is 40, is an Asian American woman, speaks to us. I don't think anyone likes racism. I mean, these white hoods and the, you know, disgusting. So we agree. But when it comes to this Black Lives Matter movement, oh wait, hashtag Black Lives Matter, again, no one likes to see black lives or unjustly accused people being shot dead for no good reason. But if you're looking for allies, that's a term nowadays, from other minorities, well, I'm Chinese American. I was born here, or Asian, and as an Asian, I hope you appreciate that I have to think first about the interests of my own group, my community. I mean, everyone does, right? As an Asian, our problems are a little different. If I'm walking down the streets or through the mall and I see a cop standing there, I'm relieved. See, Asians don't worry about getting harassed unfairly by the police or government authorities in general. Okay, maybe if you don't know English, but I mean, so long as you're well-spoken. So I hope you understand that I have to conclude it's not in my best interest to join your movement. Breaking news. The Pentagon is confirming reports that an American reconnaissance plane was shot down this morning over the South China Sea, apparently by Chinese fighter jets. The president is preparing to make a statement, and congressional Republicans are calling for retaliatory action. Black Lives Matter, bitches! Curtain.
Thanks so much, Reggie. And like you, first of all, I've never heard that piece read. So this is like the world premiere for me.
And it's
amazing. You did and so well, and with so and such with such short breath. It was so impressive. So first of all, for because many of you I haven't seen in a while, and I've gotten so much wonderful support from you all, I just want to start out by saying my neck is fine. So thank you. So in 1980, my first play, FOB, premiered at the Public Theater in New York City. And I'm a California kid, and I came to New York for the first time. And one of the people I was most excited to meet, if I could, was Jessica Hagedorn. Jessica is, you know, originally from the Bay Area, or I know, you grew up in the Bay Area, right? Okay, so, but at that time, I associated her to some extent with New York, but she had like the most impressive, coolest resume for an Asian American artist at the time. I grew up with, I had read her volume of poetry, Dangerous Music. She had done a show at the Public called Mango Tango. She hung with Entozaki Shange as part of that group, and Zaki, who wrote for Colored Girls Who've Considered Suicide, When the Rainbow is Enough. So this was somebody who I kind of looked up to and thought that if I could meet her, that some of her coolness might rub off. And, you know, so I was a 22-year-old kind of geeky Chinese kid from L.A., and I met her, and she was so incredibly kind to kind of embrace me and take me in, take me around New York, introduce me to cool people, tell me not to get too bummed out about the fact that Frank Chin hated me. And also introduced me to a very interesting recreational drug, which I've only really did that one time, but it was really fun. So Jessica was really the coolest chick that I had ever met, and she was an Asian American, and I've felt ever since then very privileged to get to run in her circle. I want to talk a little bit, you know, Jessica's such an impressive body of work. I want to talk a little bit today about Dog Eaters, the play. We all know that it was adapted from her novel, and it is this kind of kaleidoscopic portrait of the Philippines in 1982 and all its crazy contradictions. And, you know, my mom grew up in the Philippines, and I used to visit my grandparents there as a kid. So I felt very close to the material. If anything, I've spent, you know, as a kid, I spent much more time in the Philippines than I did in China, because, you know, you couldn't go into China. But it's a very difficult culture to kind of get your head around in terms of an artistic work if you're going to kind of capture all of the contradictions. And the work is political, it's hallucinogenic, it's raucous, it's sexy, but one of the things I want to focus on at this moment is just Jessica's skill as a craftsperson, as a writer. This is a play, so when you take this novel and you turn it into a play, there's, I think, like upward of 40 characters in the show. And this is we live in an age now, and this was also true in the early 2000s, late 1990s, when the play was first produced. We live in an age where if you have a play with like six people, it's really hard to get it produced. So a cast of 40 characters was an incredibly difficult feat and brave and challenging just to get it produced. But second of all, how do you keep that many characters straight? And Jessica manages to create a work which is with generals, with beauty queens, with sex workers, with Fassbinder, which really captures a whole kaleidoscope, and I think it's comparable to the huge kind of picaresque scope that authors like Dickens and Shakespeare and Cao Shui Qin managed to create in these classical works. So I think that what has impressed me about Jessica over the years, besides being the coolest chick, is that there is vision in her work. There is inspiration. There is a political purpose to it. There's an understanding of social realities and an ability to dissect that with sort of brilliant intelligence. And then this amazing skill. It's as a fellow writer, I really appreciate the craft and the ability to take something that's incredibly difficult to pull off and make it seem easy. On top of that, I think that she is genreless. You know, this is an artist and a writer who writes poetry, who writes novels, who writes plays, who writes performance pieces, who writes music, and all those things combine after the privilege of many decades of knowing Jessica now to consider her still today as the coolest chick I know. Thank you.
As I'm ending this part of the program, I wish there was a way we could multimedia it, right? Like have your mix, and then, because I'm going to show Tomie's work, anyway, a selection of it that really spoke to me, and I wish we could all just mix it all up, but we can't. And then Reggie can come up here and dance again, and I will read what I wrote, my response, and, you know, just end it that way. Is there a way to do that? Oh, my God, I love it. Amita is going to... So we can combine...
I'll give it a try.
Well, it's interesting because I was sitting there and everybody was so creative in how they spoke about the work of other artists. And I thought, oh, my God, all that stuff I was going to say. And then I said, nah, it's too long. You know, and so now I'm going to try and bring some of it back, including we do talk about our hair, David and Reggie earlier. Very important. Thank you so much. Oh, I love it. And not yet with the slides until I. I just want to say, I was sitting next to Tomie and I said, you know, when I first moved to New York, Malik, you're still here? You were in Paris. Okay. So I was sitting next to Tomie earlier and I said, Tomie, you know, I decided to move here in, I think it was 1977, 78, and I seem to remember that one of the events that let me make that decision, because I've been coming to New York quite a bit and spending time here, but living in San Francisco, and I never made the commitment, even when I started working at the Public with Zaki and Kalani and doing little pieces, I still considered the Bay Area as my home base. But in 1977 or 78, I think it was 78, Basement Workshop, which was then located on Lafayette Street, Lafayette and Spring, and was not in a basement, but up these rickety stairs and into a spacious, funky loft. They invited me to come do a reading with Benjazaki, and it was a really wonderful event and a very big deal because, you know, she was at the height of her famousness as a poet and a playwright, and it was a great event to do at Basement. And I met all these amazing Asian American artists and activists and musicians and people like Chai Ma, he was there. And I said to Tomie, were you there that night? Were you part of the collective of artists who was standing in the back? And she said, maybe. I think so. Yeah. And that was part of what I wanted to talk about tonight, the deep connection I feel. I don't have to see her every day. I mean, we all have our crazy little histories, meeting her for the first time. I think I watched a rehearsal of your play, The Family Devotions. I went and sat with you and just watched you working with all those actors and sitting there, and you were wearing white that day. I remember that vividly. And so in my memory, I have this memory of you standing in the back. But I mean, you know, that could be a wacky dream. But I love your work because it really brings me to the time coming to this country and kind of grappling with my own history of what it means to be from the Philippines, suddenly in America, and the history of Filipinos in America is not taught in the Philippines, not at least when I was growing up. I mean, maybe things have changed a little, but thing is going, not really. So there was a lot I had to catch up with, my history, and I think artists like helping me in so many ways to educate myself. So here goes. I love it. Reading in Chinese. Reading in Chinese. Subtle, mysterious, and playful. And sexy. Tomie's art explores history and memory, the complexities of being Asian, Pacific, in America, and what it means to straddle two or more worlds. I love this piece a lot because it's a peach boy in a cowboy costume. And it says everything to me about kind of who we are and how we grow up, and the look on his face, it's very eager and expectant and open, and he's very, he's ready to go out there and play as a cowboy. I am drawn to the intelligence, the elegance, and emotion in her work, and to Tomie's deep and abiding commitment to being a public artist. I mean, that's how she describes herself in her bio. Public artist. I love that she makes work that excites the public, and that she engages with the diverse communities in which her art resides. And she showed that to me earlier. Most of all, I love that she's been a public artist all the way. When I was artist in residence here in 1998, we organized a public symposium on the impact of Charlie Chan's Dead, the anthology of Asian American fiction which I edited, and the first volume which was published in 1993. So my residency at APA was a gratifying experience for all the reasons, you know, see how we are with each other, and also the reasons that so eloquently put in this introduction. You truly felt you could do, play with ideas, and try and as well as teach a book. And the experience here inspired me to put together a second volume of the anthology, which was published in 2003 and features many new writers. In response to Tomie's work, I want to read a brief excerpt from my introduction to that second volume, which I think articulates some of the things I want to say about who she is and why what she does is so relevant to the world we live in. I love this picture, and I love that we're ending with this photograph, because I think you said it was taken maybe 40 years ago, and there she is on that scaffold. And it's black and white, and it's elegant, and she's the boss. And it reminds me, it actually, it's a very beautiful photograph, and she's watching the young people, you know, doing her bidding and realizing her vision, and it's going to be this incredible mural in Chinatown. I think you told me it was East Broadway? Yeah. And you saw it earlier, but this black and white photo I found on her website, and she calls it the process page, and I said, oh my God, can we show it? Because it also reminds me of the photographs of Diego Rivera and Frida Kahlo working on the mural in Detroit in 1932, 1933, and they're in black and white, and they're all in scaffolds, and people are wearing overalls, and, you know, she's standing there telling him what she thinks, and he's ordering everybody around, and it's really grand and fabulous. And that's what she reminds me of with her little sassy hat. So with this image up, I want to read this little thing which I tweaked for tonight's occasion. Didn't have to tweak it too much because though this was written in 2003, unfortunately 2016 isn't so different from that time. Here we go. Acts of terrorism and violence have become routine. We're in a global, blood-drenched funk, cynical and despairing of the future. The sense of anxiety and blah in the air is almost palpable. But many of us go about our tasks with a nagging, low-grade fever aching in our bones. We ask ourselves the usual obvious, unanswerable questions. What does all this carnage and destruction mean for our children and children's children? But we go on. There are some things we cling to, some things we still believe. We make art and we write out of personal and terrifying truths. For many of us, what is personal is also political and vice versa. We continue to assert and explore who we are as Asians, as Asian Americans, as Asian Pacific Americans, as women, as mothers, as grandmothers, as party goers, as perennial dancers, and as citizens of the world. We make art and we write as acts of resistance and rebellion, but we also make art and we write to remember and to dream. Thank you.
Okay, so I'll just start off with a couple of questions, really. The kind of relationship between academia and art is often very, can be quite antagonistic, it can be awkward.
Oh, thank you.
And people not always talking the same languages. Artists often feeling that their kind of work and their spirit is being kind of cannibalized or kind of colonized, appropriated for kind of different kinds of ends. How did you find individually the process of being at APA when you were here? How did you find that experience? And what kind of work, what kind of projects were you working on?
You were first.
Oh, Rekha?
Yeah. I've often been the source of a academic article. There's no doubt about that. I kind of felt like, as I said before, legitimacy, and the fact that part of your residency is the option to teach. So it gave me an opportunity to academicize my work in some weird way. And it gave me, the comfort. It's like, you know, slipping into a nice down comforter on a cold winter day of an institutional support in a way that, as an artist, you just don't know and you don't see, or at least at the stage I was in my career, was really important and meant a lot to me. So for me, over time, I mean, more so with in terms of what I do, the contentiousness comes mostly from like misrepresentation or mischaracterization, or, you know, you say something and someone, you know, puts it into their work and you may or may not be credited or quoted the right way. But as far as my experiences here, the teaching was very important to me. It really pushed me. I did the beginnings of some radio work, which I'm still exploring. I still have the tape, which is has become really vital because one of the subjects I interviewed sadly passed away last year, which is State of Bengal. And re-listening to that tape last year was really incredible. And that was all part of my work here, so.
I remember also struggling with being a creature of nighttime. You struggled with daytime a little bit initially. David?
I mean, I come from a field where, you know, as a playwright and as someone who works in the theater, you're used to being reviewed in, you know, daily newspapers and magazines and things. And that type of evaluation is it's so much like a consumer guide. I mean, that the function of that sort of writing is quite shallow and judgmental. And therefore, academic writing about my work, I've always found much more interesting, and I really like it. It's like nobody likes to be criticized, and academics can criticize my work, but that's not my favorite. But I think that the sort of criticism that I get in academic writing is at least more kind of interesting and considered and nuanced than the type of, you know, when you get a bad review in a newspaper. So I like the relationship between the artist and academia. When I was here, I ended up doing a couple projects, but one that really I think was most significant for me was a kind of 20-year retrospective, because as I was saying earlier, my first play was done in 2000. Here my first play was done in 1980. I did my residency here in 2000. And so therefore it was really an opportunity after 20 years of working in New York and theater to kind of go back and look at the work and try to understand where it was that I had come over those two decades in order to hopefully, you know, set a template for the next couple of decades, which I think it really successfully did. I didn't write very many plays in the 90s. I read a bunch of other stuff. But starting, you know, in the early 2000s, I became very productive again in terms of my work at writing plays and personal, Yellowface and Chinglish and Kung Fu. And so I think that it ended up being a really important moment for me to have the curatorial point of view of an academic setting in order to look back at the past so that I could think about the future.
For me, yes, it was also about being able to teach here at NYU, but it was also just being able to engage deeper with the community at NYU. I had always worked with the youth, Asian youth group. I was never a stranger to APA. But at this point, I could really deepen my work and really celebrate spoken word. And to this day, I'm still curating Asian American spoken word performance. It really just deepened that. And the kind of work that I do is ephemeral. I'm an educator. I do slam poetry. I do stand-up comedy. I do a Tina Turner impersonation sometimes. there are no Guggenheims for those things. For me, this sort of unified, I had an opportunity to really look at what I had been doing and working on and just sharing that with a new generation of younger students.
I met Jack in Chinatown. And
do you think he was there that night too?
I've heard so many stories about the basement workshop. It's just legendary.
Night was hot.
In fact, it doesn't go by me. I mean, the irony that It's Basement Bhangra and Basement Workshop.
And Basement Bhangra was also not in a basement.
But I think there is something subterranean about the word, you know, just something ground up, you know, that really basement was a kind of metaphor for that, you know, we were all from the community or trying to understand our place in the community. And I think all of us here, in many ways, are driven by a deep love of our community. So I really have to hand it to Jack for trying to bring the community into the university setting, because I think he spent his career doing that, and acknowledging that the work that happens outside the walls of academia are really is the work that students and people here really have to connect with. But I sense that Jack was taking a risk when he asked me to be the first artist in residence, because I really didn't have those ties to academia. I'm an artist, and in the old school sense of the word, I make art. I make things, which a lot of artists don't do anymore, but I don't have a degree, and I don't feel comfortable actually in an academic setting. But you know, Jack and APA really pushed me to think about what it would mean to make work in a different context, in the context of the university, to take advantage of the resources and the research. And you know, I know that, I mean, there's proof positive that APA believes in artists, but I think that beyond that, they believe that artists need to connect with each other, they need to connect with scholars, they need to do the research that, you know, really deepens the work they're doing. And one of the greatest things about being artist in residence was that I got a library card to NYU.
Yeah, I'm serious.
To Bob's.
Yeah,
and I did all my research for the African Burial Ground mural that I did at the NYU library. So I really appreciate the confidence, I think, that the program had in my work, and their real genuine desire to bring the stuff that's happening outside in here and have the students engage with it.
I didn't get a library card.
I actually didn't get one either.
I know. I didn't know
refunds.
We could. You asked for one.
Can we still get one?
I love what you just said, because like you, Tomie, I did not come from an academic background either, and I don't have a degree except in
life.
You know,
in life?
Yeah, life. Yes. Very old school. But I do love, you know, David, what you were saying about being critiqued publicly, you know, in the newspapers, and your work comes out, and it's all done very fast, and kind of, even if it's well written, it's shallow, you know, because mm-hmm. they're writing on a time thing. But I think with the academic scholars and the way they critique us, sometimes it's really satisfying, because even if they're not liking our work, they're giving it serious mm-hmm. reflection and time and depth of criticism is what I can appreciate. And it makes you look at your work, oh, okay, I didn't know I was doing that, or what an interesting perspective. Mm-hmm. So I think spending time here, like you, Tomie, was, I'd been teaching already, so, and I had taught here once before in the creative writing program, so it wasn't so strange, but what I really loved about being at APA was it felt like a laboratory for all of us, and that they were giving us a means to explore whatever it was we wanted to explore. And I wanted to do a public sort of event involving scholars and the writers in the anthology, if we could possibly get a lot of them in and make it free and open to the public, and that happened. Plus, I wanted to teach a class on performance, and that happened, and I wanted the class to be open to whoever wanted to be in my class, if they were in the theater program, if they were in the creative writing, you know, not to, to put all these little obstacles in the students' ways. And that was made possible during the time I was in residence, and I really, really enjoyed that. I also enjoyed the interaction with a lot of the young scholars who were around, like Rosa King and Christine Balance, and having Africana studies right across the hall in the original space on Mercer Street.
Yay.
I mean, that was very, David, was that happening?
Mm-hmm.
The original space was really great because, and Swati was there, and you know, we could run across the hall and kind of, and there was a lot of collaboration going on with Africana studies, and I thought that was an amazingly fertile.
You did an event with Sapphire. Remember that?
That was amazing. Yes, so my opening event, because I think we were all asked to do some.
Swati put that together.
I said, well, I'd like to do. Oh, why don't you do a reading? Yes, but I don't want to just do a reading by myself. I said, let's do it with Sapphire. You know, and that was so great because her book had just come out, so it was, the timing was wonderful, and I think it brought all sorts of communities together, and I think that was very exciting to me, that the university at least had the wherewithal, and Jack and Sukhdev and the staff could, you know, negotiate, right? Even if you were the rebels in the room, you could at least ask that university to please fund these happenings that we were trying to do, you know, which we could never do on our own.
I like the word happening, because there's a bit of kind of sort of chaos, and kind of, we don't know what we're doing. It's a bit of wing and a prayer sometimes.
Well, yeah, but
it's, I find it, I don't know if you feel the same, I find this kind of rather discombobulating this evening. We're talking about this huge span of time, 20 years, and yet it goes by really, really quickly.
Yeah.
And is it a thing? Is it a kind of meaningful kind of entity, 20 years? Are we still the people we were 20 years ago?
Absolutely.
I
would love to also include the young woman who's here tonight, who's the current artist in residence. I mean, what do you think? I mean, this must be so weird for her to see Reggie dancing. No, but I mean, you know, if you want to chime in, because you're doing it right now, I don't know what has changed.
You're the Simba. You are. You're the residence. Yes.
Yes. I'm not discombobulated. I think we're all continuing to work, and nobody's given up, and nobody's retired. I mean, everybody's just as prolific as ever.
Yeah, I mean, I think we do change. I mean, hopefully you do change as you get. Really? I think we should change as we get.
Evolve.
Okay. So, you know, some things about us change and some things about us don't. And the things that have remain constant for all of us, and some of you are younger, but for those of us who've been around a little longer, is this, I think, continuing spirit of adventure and investigation and a continued commitment to community.
You know, I've just been given this thing. I don't know if you can
come on, let's just hang out.
Time with an exclamation mark, which seems kind of apocalyptic, but then it's got a kind of smiley face, and I don't know if that's like those diabolical clowns that are everywhere on the internet. Time. I'm crushed. Well, we're probably going to get kicked out, but hopefully there's some drinking hole or sort of dark hell we can all go on to later this evening.
Apple,
some more wine.
This is terrible.
Get some wine.
Is that still around?
We can stay here. There is ample drink. I hope you can all stay here. I'm sure you have lots of questions, responses, things that you want to talk about. I'm really, really sorry we can't do it on this platform, but we can continue the conversation over there.
On that platform. Yeah.
Thank you very much to Amita, to Laura.
All right.
And to everybody, including our panel, for being
here
this evening.
Make a toast.
A toast. to you.
This is this is cruel because we have glasses and you may not.
To the next 20 years.
Yes. An upward spiral. People in the area.